Tuesday, a park used a backhoe to dislodge limbs and other debris, blocking the flow of water under a bridge. It was successful and the water level has since gone down. The rain is a mixed blessing for farmers. Just a few weeks ago, it was much too dry, but now some farmers are saying enough is enough. Grant Reedy has more.
A few weeks ago, some farmers would have given their left arm for a rain like this. Now, some are saying enough already. Take Paul Noger.
Up until a couple weeks ago, I'd say we were as dry this spring as we've ever been. And then last Sunday, we had about 2 inches, which really was a blessing. We needed that real bad. And now this rain time, and it seems like it's done more damage than it did good.
Paul's soybean field has gone from practically bone dry to underwater. Some of the plants are now completely submerged.
So this part of the area of the field here, it's ruined for right now.
On this farm, in heavy rains, the creeks flood. It rained so hard yesterday, part of this bridge washed out. Crews were out this morning fixing it.
Just too much rain, too far high. They just jumped the road, the bridge, and got the road a little bit like that.
Not counting today's rain, parts of Cape County in the last 3 weeks have picked up 6 inches. When it comes to rain, it's a fine line between not enough and too much.
People were very well satisfied with the way the crops looked. Now, the rain, as they were getting right now, of course, is changing the situation. We really don't need this rain we're getting right now.
Paul Noder says it's all part of farming.
I went from real dry to real wet. You know, to put it simply, but that's just the way it goes with farming. You know, you never can predict the weather.
And 2 months from now, who knows what the weather will be? In Cape County, Grant Reedy, Heartland News.
Two Penobscot County families are happy to be alive this evening. Yesterday afternoon, a tornado ripped through the southern portion of that county near Steele. Families and friends spent the day picking up the pieces of their homes and lives. Mary Ann Maloney reports.
Family members and friends spent much of last night and all of today trying to clean up the gnarled mess left behind by the tornado at Sue and Carl Christian's farm. The tornado hit at about 5:30 yesterday afternoon, slicing a destructive path across the Arkansas-Missouri line, leaving in its wake severed trees and crushed buildings.
Most of the world was in the midst of the fire.
Sue Clifton was in her yard when she spotted the funnel cloud. Already on the ground, just a mile away, the twister raced towards her.
I just looked up and saw that thing coming at me, and all I could think of was getting the fence. I mean, really, I don't know if it was rusted or what it was like. I don't know.
Every window in the house except one was blown out. Their belongings are scattered across a mile and a half of farmland.
Well, this is what we put together here in the last thing, you know. Takes about a minute to get rid of it.
The Christians are lucky. They suffered only minor damage compared to their neighbors who live just 100 yards down the road. Charlie and Tanisha Stevens' property stood directly in the path of the tornado. Today, all that remains of their three-bedroom home is a twisted pile of wood and shingles.
We waited until it got between a quarter and a half a mile from the house, and we jumped in our car and we left.
The Stevens knew they had no other choice but to try and outrun the tornado. A pile of debris marks the spot where their home once stood. Although other damage has been reported, the Christians and Stevens were hardest hit by the twister. Although neither is bitter, saying that homes and cars can be replaced, they're thankful to be alive and have the chance to start over. In Penobscot County, Mary Ann Maloney, Heartland News.
A Steele woman has died after suffering a heart attack during yesterday's tornado. Adeline Haynes died late this afternoon at a Blytheville, Arkansas hospital. Haynes and her sister were driving down County Road 563 when Haynes had a heart attack. They pulled into the Clifton's driveway for help. Carl Clifton took them downstairs into the storm shelter and administered CPR for 40 minutes before the ambulance arrived. Well, a jury is deciding how to punish a man convicted of killing a 10-year-old girl.
We'll have the latest from Alney on the Cecil Sutherland sentencing next. This is your home-owned Horner Rack Optical Superstore, an eyewear
have their backs to luck? Some guys always wear rally hats. Others try to catch his head. Me? I take my relief pitcher to Pizza Hut before every game.
Now, buy a Pizza Hut pizza and get a relief pitcher for just $2.49. Then get free Pepsi fill-ups all summer with any dinner-sized pizza to go. Every pitcher sold helps support Little League of America.
And a great relief pitcher, maybe you don't need super chicken.
Sugar Ray Leonard and Thomas Hitman Haynes are going to war.
$150 million budget shortfall. Ashcroft told the committee. teaching how to talk to your own son?
Nope. They taught us how to listen to each other. And you know something? I'm finally getting to know Billy, and he's getting to know me, too.
Learn to listen to your son or daughter. Call the Community Counseling Center. Meteorologist John McNeil, Bob Reed, and Bryan Alworth, KFVS 12 Storm Team.
Bryan, can you tell us the rain has let up, but only let up? It's kind of gone, but not forgotten. In fact, if you look at Centine Meadow right now, after 150 miles, still quite a bit of activity out there, sort of on the fringes of our viewing area. We have a line of impressive thunderstorms all the way from northeastern Arkansas back up around Murray, Kentucky. This line moving to the northeast, so parts of western Kentucky over the next couple of hours could see some more heavy rain. And out to our west, just moving into the western part of the viewing area, some lighter showers and thunder showers. And these look like they will hold together at least long enough to bring some rain to parts of southeastern Missouri over the next couple of hours. The numbers for today, well, let's look and see what we had. Well, this morning, a mild 68 degrees, but with the clouds coming in fairly early this morning, we only got up to 76. Kind of a humid, but not too hot day. Our current temperature is 70 degrees, wind south at 14 miles an hour. Humidity very high, 95% barometer. Fairly low and still dropping, 29.80 inches of mercury and headed down. Precipitation officially since midnight at the airport, 1.21. Our total storm to date total here at KFVS, about 3 3/4 inches of rain so far since yesterday. And our sunrise tomorrow, 5:36, and our sunset at 8:17. Some of the precipitation that we've recorded from yesterday into today, in fact, up to about an hour and a half ago, these are fairly recent totals. I'll stand back out of the way here. You can see the heaviest rains have been through the southern part of the area. Phoenix reporting about 4.6 inches, the same in Union City. Two weather watchers called from Avalanche with about 5.4 inches of rain, but up farther north, not quite as heavy. Fredericktown picked up about 1.6 inches of rain over the last 36 hours. Carbondale officially 2.6 at the airport there. And I just talked to Harvey Trollope in Perryville, and he only had about 1.1 inches of rain. So not everybody got the extremely heavy rain, but enough of the heartland did get some heavy rain to make it a potentially serious situation. Potentially serious because we do have a good chance of some more rain later tonight and tomorrow. The National Satellite Dish is showing quite a bit of cloud cover through the south central part of the U.S. back up into the Ohio Valley. We had some severe weather, not right here in the heartland today, although we did have a tunnel cloud reported down in the Blue Tier again. That near Louisville, Kentucky, a tornado touchdown earlier this afternoon. We also had some flash flood watches out for parts of the south central plains as more rain is falling out there. Also, a little area of showers and thunderstorms engulfing much of Colorado this evening with some upslope flow through the mountains. Late this afternoon, this is what we saw across our area. The country is basically in the 70s and 80s, depending on how much cloud cover was around. We do have a front coming in from the northwest, which would be great. As soon as it moves through, we could start to stabilize, cool off, and become quite pleasant. The trouble is, this time of year, these fronts tend to stall out and move very slowly as they move into the mid-Mississippi Valley, and that's exactly what's going to happen over the next 24 hours. These fronts are going to kind of move very slowly through the area, so we're not looking for any quick relief. We still have a good chance of showers and thunderstorms later on tonight into tomorrow, and once again, some of those could be heavy. Our forecast not showing that front moving right through the heartland by tomorrow evening, and until it gets through and a little bit to the south and east of us, we are still going to be susceptible to some showers and thunderstorms, some of those possibly heavy, maybe even severe. So be on the lookout and keep an eye on the sky, I guess would be the best way to put it, especially with the heavy rains we've already had around the area. Here's our forecast for tonight, and we're looking for partly cloudy skies with just a chance of showers and thunderstorms overnight, about a 40% chance it looks like overnight. The temperature is dropping to between 64 and 70 degrees. Tomorrow, though, mostly cloudy. We will see some sunshine, I think, with a good chance of showers and thunderstorms as that front moves in closer. Highs tomorrow between about 78 and 86 degrees. The south winds at 10 to 15. Here's a four-day forecast. Showers and thunderstorms tomorrow, a good bet. Once again, some of those could be heavy. But then the Wednesday, we start to clear out and cool off. A high of only about 78. And Thursday and Friday should be quite nice for this time of year. It's highs in the 70s with clear to partly cloudy skies. And of course, Mike, no secret, with 4 inches of rain over the last 24 to 36 hours, any more would be a problem, so we will be watching.
What a table event.
Definitely.
Thank you, Bryan. Soybeans lower, grains mixed at the close today on the Board of Trade. Soybeans 2.5 to 11 and a quarter lower. Corn futures 2.25 lower to 4 higher. And the wheat finish 1.75 lower to 2.25 higher. Randy has highlights of the Cards going for a sweep at Wrigley.
And on Heartland Outdoors, Randy goes fishing with SIU University Athletic Director Jim Hart. show. Make Westpac Mall a part of your life.
Introducing the only way to control Johnson Gas from Bermuda Gas that's more effective than Fusilade 2000 herbicide. Fusilade 2000 from ITI. In the battle against Johnson Grass and Bermuda Grass, modern technology has spent years trying to develop a weapon that's faster and more effective than Fusilade 2000. They still are.
I'm Joe Hillis from Black City Ford Lincoln Mercury Toyota. I want you to think about something very important. The best car repair guarantee in America, as the director of our parts and service, Gary Simmons, will tell you about. Ford Motor Company Lifetime Service Guarantee covers thousands of parts for your Ford, Lincoln, and Mercury. Come in and ask for a free copy of our Lifetime Service Guarantee. Remember, free labor, free parts. That's our commitment. Black City Ford Lincoln Mercury Toyota.
If you need to know more about AIDS and AIDS prevention, information is available. Call your local AIDS hotline or 1-800-342-AIDS.
I know a lot of people, even in England, taking sides on the pubs and pubs game.
A lot of good nations, too. It's hard to sweep another ball club because teams are so even. The Chicago Cubs offense did come alive today and beat the Cardinals 10-3. So the Cubs salvaged one game of that four-game series. Here's some of today's action out of Wrigley Field. There's a 2-2 ball game in the third inning when this guy, Ryan Sandberg, comes through with a base hit. Off Scott Perry, this will score Jerome Walton. Cubs had the lead 3-2. Sandberg had a great day, drove in three runs. He also homered. Now in the fourth inning, with a runner on first and second, a bunt. Scott Perry throws it past first base. Another run scores, making it 4-2. Cubs went on to beat the Cardinals today. The final 10-3. The Cubs win it. So the Cardinals wrap up a very successful 6-2 road trip. And tomorrow night, they will host Montreal in the first of a three-game series. Well, it's always fun to go fishing, and this week's Heartland Outdoor segment was a lot of fun for me. I went fishing with a pro fisherman and a former NFL quarterback.
Like most of us, Jim Hart enjoys taking time out from a busy schedule to do a little fishing.
I usually do it late in the afternoon after I get home from work and go down by the pond and put the pole in the water. But then on weekends when you got honeydews, can't be like these professionals like Andrew can go out and do it for a living and have so much fun. So I just like to pick my times to have fun, but I really do enjoy it.
And we were all set to enjoy this outing. And Brett Dickley, who fishes the professional circuit, knew exactly where to take it.
Well, most of the fish this time of year, the hotter it gets, the more they move out into the brush pile to leave the grass. But the oxygen level lately has been in the grass. The tournament last weekend, most of the fish were caught in the grass there. So that's what we're going to try now.
And it didn't take long to get a bite.
He's a pretty good bite. He's probably a couple pounds, 3.5 pounds.
Did he hit the water or did he hit the water?
No, I hit it. I crunched it down here on the rattle side. Side, didn't I? I'd be a keeper out here if I got a